Hi, I'm Dr. Leslie Blankenship-Williams, and we are going to continue our discussion with mutagens by looking at two physical agents that cause mutations. They are both high energy waves that are found on the electromagnetic spectrum. So when we think about wavelengths, electromagnetic wavelengths, we know that wavelengths can be pretty big and low energy, or they can be really tight and high energy. And we can see that in this image here, where as we move from left to right, we get to higher and higher energy. Visible light is here, but then directly to the right of it here is UV light or ultraviolet light. And then as you move farther over, you get into a group that are called the ionizing radiation, which includes X-rays and gamma radiation. Now, these higher energy electromagnetic waves have a tendency to excite electrons. What does that mean? So, in basic chemistry, electrons exist in an orbital. And if they accept or absorb certain amounts of electromagnetic energy, they can be popped out of that orbital into a higher orbital. When the electromagnetic energy dissipates or disappears, they fall back down into their original orbital. Usually. So again, the excitation of electrons is popping them out of their orbital and then they fall back down. It's like, hi, I'm excited. Okay, I'm back down to where I was. Occasionally when they pop out and then they fall back down, they may not fall back down in the same way that they started. And that happens when DNA bases or certain DNA bases are exposed to ultraviolet light. So let's first take a look at how UV irradiation causes mutations. So when UV irradiation hits two adjacent thymines, like I'm shown here, the two adjacent thymines can have their electrons excited. And when the electrons fall back down, sometimes they actually fall back down together, such that a new covalent bond is formed between the adjacent thymines. So let's take a look here and see what I mean. So we've got UV light that is going to be hitting these adjacent thymines. The electrons pop up. When they fall back down, the electrons actually fall back down in a way that they are shared between the two thymines, which should not happen. This is referred to as a thymine dimer. So UV irradiation is notorious for causing thymine dimers. So again, this is where two adjacent thymines on the same DNA strand are now sharing four electrons in this double covalent bond. Now, why is that a problem? If you imagine for a moment that I am a thymine and I'm sitting here by myself, and there's my adenine up there, and I'm looking at my adenine and forming two hydrogen bonds with my adenine and totally happy with my adenine. And then my electrons get excited, and when they fall back down, I somehow now get compelled to be linked to the thymine next to me. What happens is my base ends up kind of getting pulled down a little bit like this, and therefore is no longer available to be hydrogen bonding with the adenines. So let me draw that real quick. So I drew these little question marks by the adenine, like, where did our partners go? Why are they all over there clicky? How come they're not bonding with us anymore? Now you might notice that I have drawn this like a bulge. So the reason why I drew it with a bulge in the thymine dimer is because it actually happens in the double helix. The double helix should be equidistant all the way around, meaning that if I were to take a double helix and take my hands and kind of feel along that double helix, the width of my hands should not change. So if I'm feeling, it should feel like, yes, everything feels right. But imagine if there's a thymine dimer, there's going to be a big bulge there. So I actually can utilize that fact to identify where the thymine dimers are. And so if I can identify where the thymine dimers are, I can remove them and replace them with fresh thymine before the next round of DNA replication hits. Remember, the mutation is not set in stone until the next round of DNA replication. So before I get into the repair mechanism, which does exist, let me briefly talk about why this causes a mutation. So when DNA polymerase comes along and tries to read that, we know that it should be putting two adenines there. But it doesn't see much. It just comes over and it's like nothing fits because the thymines are all cloistered down and hiding. And so DNA polymerase may only recognize one thing in that space, or might recognize that there's two things, and it just kind of guesses and moves on. And so you can see in my example, there should be two A's, but now there's a C and an A. And this is where the mutation comes in. So it's really important to get rid of the thymine dimers before DNA polymerase replicates that DNA strand. So let's talk about that repair mechanism. The fact that thymine dimers cause a bulge, like there, is fortuitous because it gives us an easy way to find them. So there is an enzyme, kind of a correction enzyme, that E. coli has called photolyase. And photolyase is responsible for finding and replacing those errant thymines. Now the word photo means light, and lyase refers to ligating, which means cutting and repairing this nucleic acid sequence. So photolyase is going to basically feel along that double helix, find the bulge, and then it's going to go through and cut out the region, and then it's going to replace it with fresh thymine so that there is no mutation that shows up. Now, most bacteria have photolyase or something comparable. In E. coli, photolyase is only activated in the light. In other words, it has to be light outside for this enzyme to work. Now, why would that be the case? Why not be active all the time? Well, UV light usually only shows up when visible light shows up. If you think about the sun, for instance, UV light and visible light are both produced at the same time. When it's dark out, the bacteria are not going to be exposed to much UV light, if at all. So the risk of thymine dimers is much lower. So the enzyme is only activated when visible light is there, and then it will start kind of climbing up and down, I think climbing up and down like a monkey, climbing up and down this double DNA helix looking for bulges and replacing them with fresh thymine when it finds them. Humans also have a comparable type of correction enzyme. And that's a good thing because thymine dimers happen all the time. So in our bodies, the place that is most likely to get UV irradiation is our skin. And when our stem cells in our skin, specifically our epidermis, or perhaps melanocytes, get thymine dimers, and they don't get corrected in time, those thymine dimers can lead to mutations. If you get enough mutations accumulating in any of those stem cells, then you can get skin cancer. So UV irradiation leads to skin cancer. If we did not have a repair mechanism, then we would all have skin cancer by the time we were like 4 years old. So that repair mechanism is really fantastic, but even still, it doesn't catch every last thymine dimer, clearly, because skin cancer is still occurring in our population. So that ends our discussion on UV irradiation. Let's take a quick look at ionizing radiation. So ionizing radiation is going to be the higher energy X-rays and gamma rays. And so what we're going to do is kind of briefly talk about how this works. Now, the word ionizing radiation tells you exactly what it does. It creates ions. So if you go back and take a look at the structure of any nitrogenous base, you will see a lot of N's and O's and C's and H's, but you will not see a charge. Now, DNA is negatively charged, but only on the sugar phosphate backbone. The actual nitrogenous bases themselves are polar, but not ions. So ionizing radiation causes the electrons to pop off so much that they actually become ions. When they become ions, they're no longer forming hydrogen bonds. So when DNA polymerase goes to try to match a base that has been ionized, it cannot find a match. And again, just randomly puts something there, crosses its fingers that it's the right thing, and moves on. And so consequently, ionizing radiation can lead to lots of mutations. It should not be a surprise then that frequent exposure to X-rays can lead to cancer, especially cancer in the bone marrow, like leukemia. Gamma radiation is even more problematic. And if you are exposed to very, very high levels of gamma radiation, the actual covalent bonds in the double, in the sugar phosphate backbone end up shattering. And I think of it like somebody spinning DNA like glass and then throwing it on the floor and just watching it shatter everywhere. So you hear about people that die within a couple hours after extreme nuclear exposure, and they're referring to the shattering of the DNA from gamma irradiation. You cannot recover from it. Anyway, that concludes our lecture of looking at the kind of morbid but fascinating world of physical mutagens and how they cause mutations. Thanks.